Let's go to another big issue, long-standing issue that we haven't talked about for a few days, and I want to catch up with Alan Moran from Regulation Economics. He joins us from Melbourne. Alan, you responded to me when I wrote about the renewable energy transition a few weeks ago, and I suggested that there's all sorts of costs involved here, but I said that in terms of what our tax dollars how much of our tax dollars have been spent directly on the transition, I said at least $20 billion. Now, you've corrected me, so I've underestimated that by probably 30%. You reckon we've already spent in direct tax dollars $30 billion on this transition?
I think at least that, actually, Chris. We started off pretty small back in 2006. It was like $400 million a year. But we've added to the programs and expanded the existing programs. And there's any number of acronyms of new programs of the CEFC, ARENA, a whole lot of others. You add them all up, and the government doesn't do it for us, used to do it, but it doesn't do it for us. You add them all up and we're presently spending at the rate of $15 billion a year. So basically we've trajected up, and I would say we would have spent at least $30 billion so far, and the trajectory is all going upwards still. We haven't seen any renewables produced in Australia which have been produced without a subsidy. The subsidy is at least 50% of what of the price that they receive. And in doing so, they basically not only use the ratepayers and the taxpayers' money, but they've been used to kill the most efficient, low-cost form of electricity we have, which is coal. Coal has gone from about 75% to maybe 55%, and now governments are really concerned that it may be going too quickly, and they're actually subsidising coal as well as subsidising the sorts of things that are killing it off. You know, it's sort of like we're spending money on bombs to actually destroy productive activities.
It is bizarre, and the point is that we've spent all this money, and we now have power that's more expensive than it's ever been and less reliable than it's ever been. So we're going pretty well on this. It's just extraordinary. Just on the cost, though, you say it's you've tallied it up at over $15 billion a year now. I'm old enough to remember, going back a decade or so, governments would boast about their total spend on climate and renewable energy. They would say we're spending $5 billion this year or whatever. Have governments started to become embarrassed about the spend because they don't collate it all together for us anymore?
You bang on the nail there. I think that's dead right. Until about 2011, 2012, there was items in the budget which he's totted it all up and said there's all this happening and that's happening, and you could easily identify it. Now it's dispersed over, there must be two dozen or three dozen different programs, and some of which are not clearly identified as what the cost would be, and some of them go into the future and you can't really identify from year to year. It does not make it easy to understand, and one would imagine that governments are embarrassed.
Yeah, they must be, and that's why we're grateful to people like you who actually tally it all up for us. Just before I let you go, of course, this is only the taxpayer spend at $15 billion a year and $30 billion in total. Of course, on top of that, there's private investment on those subsidised renewables and transmission and batteries and the like. And we all have to pay for that in the end through the higher electricity prices. They have to get a return on their capital. What is the total private spend so far, do you think? Is it over $100 billion?
Oh, it'd certainly be over that. And the interesting thing is that this private spend to actually increase our costs. And I think it was the chairman of the CEFC, one of the soft loan outfits that lend to these things, to the private sector, said, oh, we're not crowding private money out, we're crowding it in. In other words, we're bringing private sector investment into something which is highly suboptimal, in fact, negative value in terms of, and we think that that's a good thing. At least the government's appointees think it's a good thing.
Strange.
Essentially, we are cannibalising investment capital to actually kill off efficient investments and productive investments.
Which is why I call it national self-harm on a grand scale. Thanks so much for unpicking that for us, Alan. I appreciate it. Alan Moran there from Regulation Economics.